when we think about the horrible and unimaginable damage to the environment, which is caused by the war in Ukraine, it actually is part of a long litany in ancient history of conflict. Now, I want to say that much of what I'm talking about is influenced by Dr. Richard Tucker, who's a lecturer in conflict and the environment, University of Michigan. His book is highly recommended for those who want. But basically, there's nothing new about collective violence. People have been fighting and killing and hurting each other for as long as there have been people. And you only need to open the book of Genesis to find examples of that. In fact, it's not just humans who kill each other. One of the most disturbing findings, I think, of Jane Goodall when she started to really get to know the chimpanzees better is they kill each other also. In fact, they not only kill each other, they eat each other as well. But what's changed, of course, is our technology and our ability to cause damage, not only to ourselves, but into the environment around us. Now, if we look around at the world, we see that there's a long history where so-called primitive societies would fight each other. And we know that in the buffer zones, in the areas between those, that was where nature really flourished, that areas that were always under conflict and siege, there was damage. So all over the world, we see these kind of buffer zones, and that's sort of the silver lining of conflict, that even though there's usually tremendous damage, there are places on the edges which survive. But the one thing that changed over history that became more and more significant is the role of fire in taking out of forests and burning them down. Certainly that's something that we saw in Australia, which has transformed their landscape as well. But really the environmental impact of war started to pick up as human society became more urbanized, where there was more surplus to provide for technologies and more complex political and military organizations. And the wars became longer, and there was an ability and a supply chain to keep them going. And the damages became more and more significant. 700 BC, we see the first time that we see that as part of a military conflict, canals and dams were open and cities were devastated using the environment within the context of a war. And if we look at the even our own history of the conquering of Canaan by the children of Israel as they came out of the 40 years in the desert, one of the most disturbing quotes, if you look at the book of Joshua, involves what Joshua told his people who, when they were giving out the lands, they were very unhappy because some of it was wood. And he said, well, if it's too narrow for you, if it's a forest, just cut it down and make the products of it. So there was a long history of that. And indeed, the Greek landscape is informed by many, many, many centuries of conflict 2,000 years ago, and it never recovered. There used to be lush forests in Greece, but it didn't survive that. And when the Romans led siege in Jerusalem, you need only open up the book of Josephus to see how within kilometers radius around Jerusalem, there was not a tree left, according to his testimonial, because the Romans had a scorch and burn policy even back then. If we go fast forward locally, we can think about the Crusaders, who relatively were benign environmentally. We only have a few extinctions that we can credit to the fallow deer, which we brought back. But if we look in the world, as the naval forces became larger, the forest gave way so that we could produce these incredible fleets of boats. And this was the initial impact, besides the destruction of forests, was taking them down for that. But once we got into firearms, things changed. The paradox, of course, is that when you have guns, you can shorten siege when you have gunpowder, and that's good for the environment when you can shorten siege, but of course, more deadly for humans. But this all took a real change as the Industrial Revolution came forward and European colonialism, its ugly head. And I would strongly recommend, it's an old book, but it's really fairly definitive, Jared Diamond's Guns, Germs, and Steel, about how it was that Europe came to conquer all these colonial lands to the south. And all of a sudden, there was a tremendous financial incentives with having colonial conquering. One of the more, I would say, disturbing chapters in this, of course, is the use of biological warfare, the spread of smallpox. For those, I hope there's nobody in the audience who was a student at in Western Massachusetts, because there we have the case where they gave out blankets to Indians knowing that they were infected with smallpox. And the results were just disastrous. Anyway, as the Europe becomes more and more industrial, we see broader and broader conflicts going to further and further ranges. The US Civil War is a turning point in terms of the willingness and the ability to decimate an area. General Sheridan received orders to destroy all live crops and buildings, and then General Sherman's March to the Sea, which is immemorialized, whatever, in Gone with the Wind. We see just how much impact war can have on the environment. And the lessons of the Civil War were quickly applied by General Ulysses Grant, who'd used them against the indigenous people of the United States, said, let's extirpate the bison. And the killing of the bison across the US was part of his ability to really try to overcome any kind of resistance on the part of the local Indian tribes of the West. This same technology and the same approach to using the environment and just leaving no trees left there was exactly what England did to subdue the Boers back in South Africa. And when they were not winning the war quickly enough, they just used ecological warfare, bringing down the Boer farms where they moved the people out of their lands and just destroyed all of their farmlands. And now we move up to the 20th century when all of a sudden we scale up and we see that the Germans, when they were attacking, really left nothing in their midst, and any kind of ecological system which exists now is a secondary one because none of the original ones were done. And then of course they introduced chemical warfare, which took a human toll, but let's think about all the wildlife that was exposed to gas warfare that had no gas masks and no place to run, and how much that affected them. And of course it inspired a whole pesticide industry as well. A few more slides and we'll get to the Ukraine. World War II. 70 million people die, unimaginable casualties, but the forest paid a huge price as well. Hundreds of square kilometers were just lost as they were bombed into submission. And planes also began to take wood as well. But of course, nuclear arms changed everything. The ability of humans to just erase entire ecosystems became unheard of. And we now know that a word or two about landmines and what the toll it takes on the mammal have to walk across in and are taken apart. And of course, the leftover factories, the munitions plants, which turn into gray fields. So there's a lot of bad things, and I haven't even gotten to Agent Orange and what happened in Vietnam or whatever, because I do want to talk about the Ukraine, which is the topic of today's discussion. So we have traumatic situation for all of us in the Ukraine, because this is a war that we never thought we'd be seeing in Europe in our lifetime. We thought we were beyond that. And of course, we've all seen the tremendous loss of human lives. But because that's the topic of this day's discussion, I wanted to highlight five areas where we see environmental damage today in the Ukraine and what it's kind of a legacy that's going to leave. So the intentional targeting of industrial sources by the Russians, because they know that they're going to leave the impact on the environment. Abandoned mines, which is, I don't think, intentional, but there's several hundred mines in the greater Ukraine area. And if they're not taken care of, particularly when those that are abandoned, they will leave the contiguous groundwater completely decimated and contaminated. Radiation concerns. I think 12, I have the number in the slide coming up of the number of Chernobyls that exist in the Ukraine. Of course, nuclear power being the number one source of energy and what that means. And actually just the explosives themselves, what kind of exposures they do. And then finally, let's talk a little bit about the animals. I'm gonna talk about all five of these and then we'll wrap it up and talk a little about what it means for us in the region. So here's a picture of one of many you could have picked, where a petroleum product site in Odessa was hit just yesterday. We know they hit the port there as well. And you can imagine what the emissions are like in terms of human health and the impact on the carbon footprint that's associated with this. Nitric acid is particularly toxic, and we've seen several hits as well. Here's just a particular one that I gave you the example of. The second example I want to talk about was the decommissioning of mines. Here's an old mine which stopped being used during the previous Russian incursion into the Ukraine. And we can see already the mapping, which has been done remotely, where heavy metals and sometimes even nuclear fuels make their way, leach into the soil, and eventually reach the groundwater. Take a look at something like this here, and I don't hope I butchered the name too bad, but Komishuvakara, whatever, the river's contaminated by the mines, where if you don't pump the water out and treat it, you're just going to be leaving future generations with a toxic legacy which they'll never be able to get behind. We all remember as Russia approached Chernobyl that they measured 28 times above the annual limits. In other words, we're not exactly sure how, but the genie in the bottle got let out, and eventually Russia made its way out because its soldiers were getting sick. But there are 15 nuclear reactors in the Ukraine, and any one of them could be a Chernobyl if they are hit, and something that we need to be deeply concerned about. Now, today's weaponry has a variety of chemicals in them, and some of them leave behind a variety of exposures to the local population, cyanide, nitric oxide, and the like. And these are things which are well. And the last thing I sort of want to touch on is the notion of the biodiversity. I mean, Ukraine, it turns out, is a remarkable place in terms of nature, 6% of the European land, but has 35% of its biodiversity. There are 70,000 rare and endemic species in Ukraine. I mean, in Israel, where we have 100 mammal species, we have 2,000 plants. This is much, much more than we have. 16% of land is covered by forest. And so the potential to be damaged is extremely great. And we need to be concerned about that. Now, in the big picture, you can always argue that because of the military, there are buffer zones. And many areas, there's been books written about this, where nature flourishes because somewhere along the line, when nations finally make peace and there are demilitarized zones, those are de facto nature reserves. And that's something which is maybe good. And you can look at perhaps the most famous one between North and South Korea. There's several, if I was teaching a course, which I do teach actually in conflict in the environment, we might look at some of the amazing things that have come out along this demilitarized zone, which has really blossomed into a tremendous, but on the whole, Chernobyl is an example of what happens when an area becomes contaminated and how nature becomes comes back. And so we have that as well. Before I wrap up this sort of brief presentation, I just want to say that we in the Middle East have our own environmental legacy. And we in the Middle East need to remember that warfare harms people, but it does harm the environment. As we try to cobble together some sort of a climate strategy, as we try to get how we're going to preserve biodiversity, stopping the next war and finding ways to reach a harmonious environment here in the region has much, much more than just benefits for humans. It also means that the ecosystems that surround us will also be the beneficiaries. And as we look at the way that the forests of Israel paid and the lands around the country paid for it, I think we need to redouble our efforts to do that. So I sort of want to wrap up with this final thing. We all know the Leo Tolstoy line from, I think it's where he opens up Anna Karenina, happy families are all alike, even unhappy families. Every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. And I sort of say that healthy ecosystems are alike free of conflict, but when you have unhappy ecosystems, each conflict has its own story and its own way of doing that. The general rule is that there's no greater environmental hazards than warfare than we think about the many, many challenges mentally. Perhaps the single best thing we can do for the environment is make peace. And that's something we need to be constantly, because violence between humans, if we could just contain it, that'd be one thing, but ultimately becomes violence to the earth. So that is the extent of my presentation. And I thought we could now maybe open it up to discussion and take your questions and comments for those who might have. and see what you want to take it. And if people want to move on to other topics, I see this as an opportunity to discuss about anything environmental, political, or otherwise that's going on in Israel and the region. Teddy, back to you.
Okay, thank you. Maybe let's try and keep it focused on this topic at first, and then we'll expand. So we got a question specifically about the quality of water in rivers in eastern Ukraine. I don't know if you can speak to that.
I'm not an expert on it. The interesting thing is in the Ukraine, only 65% of the houses are actually hooked up to sewage lines, which is sort of an amazing thing. I mean, even the Palestinians, 95% of them are hooked up to sewage by now. So we don't have that. But because there's a large rural community there, remember, it's the breadbasket to some extent of Europe. The real concern to the streams has always been the problem of the sewage discharges into streams. But I think as a result of the war now, with all infrastructure taking such a hit, even those existing sewage systems are bombed out and refugees are moving into areas. So I haven't seen any specific data, but I can only assume that it's bad news in terms of the streams and rivers. The one small silly consolation is that streams in Eastern Europe are rushing mighty Volga rivers. They're not like our sort of wimpy Middle Eastern streams that are intermittent and the like. So presumably that some of the dilution that goes on there can be of help. But I can't imagine that it's a good one with so much infrastructure damage, sewage treatment plants no longer functional and the like.
Okay, another question that came in beforehand, if you could discuss carbon emissions from military action. And then they echoed what you just said. They said, isn't it time to give peace a chance?
Well, sure it is. You know, there's sort of two different perspectives now with regard to Israel's relations with Russia over the war. There's, you know, I don't know how many of you are following this, but just last week we had a disturbing message from the Ministry of Justice in Russia, which now wants to close the Jewish Agency office, the same office that processes requests to move to Israel and immigration and what I, but, and many people say, gee, you know, the Israeli government needs to be much more cautious and needs to rein itself in and treat Putin with kid gloves. But more and more people, including somebody like Anatoly Natan Sharansky, who was head of the Jewish Agency, says, no, this is a moment when the moral character of the Jewish state comes under question. It's a very, very complicated issue because on the one hand, we have an ethical commitment to the Jews of of Russia to bring them back to Israel if they should so desire and create the political circumstances that makes that possible. On the other hand, we certainly can't be on the wrong side of history. So I'm not sure how I would address that issue. But remind me, it's a specific question again, now that I've rambled on a bit, Teddy. I don't think carbon emissions from the military activities. Well, of course they're terrible. They don't have electric vehicles. They have very few emissions. You ever see emission specifications for a tank? They don't have them. Okay. So yeah, the warfare in general produces tremendous amounts of carbon, and there's just not a whole lot that can be done about it. So the sooner you can end conflict, that's the best thing you can do for reducing carbon emissions.
And then, on the same note, Angela asks about statistics in Israel specifically about how much the climate has been impacted by warfare. We're running twice the average heat increase of the world generally. Can we say that military emissions from warfare has had a serious impact in Israel specifically?
Well the underlying injustice of climate is that it doesn't really make a difference how much you emit of greenhouse gases. That in no way affects whether or not you're going to be a climate winner or loser, or whether you're going to be affected. The entire Middle East is considered to be a climate hotspot. We have the sea level rise, pretty much twice the rises in temperature that other places do, but that has nothing to do with our emissions. But having said that, the Middle Eastern emissions are pretty high. You look at a country like Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, any of these oil producers, they have tremendous carbon emissions. So it kind of goes together. Israel's emissions per capita have gone down, But actually, when we think about the fact that our population is growing so quickly, the overall emissions have increased. So I would like to hope that we could do a lot better, a lot sooner. In one area, you can say that Israel has improved in that as we've shifted most of our electricity away from coal to natural gas. But even natural gas, as time goes on, we learn has much more of a carbon footprint than we ever imagined because of the fugitive emissions when we extract natural gas from the sea. And in general, methane is a far more powerful greenhouse gas than, say, carbon dioxide.